Good morning, everybody. I am S. Balakrishnan. I'll be the host for this session. A brief introduction about myself. I'm a former journalist from the Times of India. I retired after 36 years from this organization as the city editor and chief of bureau. I am now practicing criminal law in Bombay High Court. And we have in the panel today two distinguished administrators, IAS officers. We start with Mr. Sanjay Bhatia, who has got 34 years as a career IAS officer. He is currently of the rank of secretary in the government of India, and he has held extremely wide range of positions. Right now, he is chairman of the Mumbai Port Trust. Before that, he was the sales tax commissioner. He was the managing director of Sirco, one of the largest of the national government, in charge of implementing the new airport. And the USP of his career has been his fight for transparency. He has got several awards for that. And as the sales tax commissioner of Maharashtra, I clearly remember, he brought in so many reforms, introduced so much of transparency, which resulted in the government of Maharashtra gaining hundreds of crores of rupees was going down the drain otherwise. And he has been practicing heartfulness, Sahajpath meditation for the past over 20 years. Next on the panel, we have Mr. Ravindra Jalan, who belongs to the 1995 IAS batch. And right now he's with the government of Sikkim, where he has held a wide range of positions as collector of three districts, and then as the secretary to various big departments, including education, agriculture, and he was also the chief election commissioner for the 2019 elections. He, like Mr. Bhatia, is also an engineer. He did his M.Tech from IIT Kanpur in robotics. And both of them would have had excellent careers in the private sector, but they chose to work for the nation, work for the people of this country. Welcome to both of you.
Thank you.
The topic for today is life balance. How do you balance your life with your work and then all the associated things? So I first start off by asking Mr. Bhatia, why do we make a distinction between life and work? I thought work was part of life, rather an important component of life. Do you, what is your take on this?
Yeah, I agree with you. Both the work and the spiritual side, both are part of life itself. And I think the question which is being raised is that whether you're working too much or whether you are doing something else too much. So a balance between the two is what is probably the topic which we are discussing.
Okay. So,
yeah. You want me to elaborate on?
Please.
Okay. So I have been able to do this work-life balance because since about now 20 years, I have started this heartfulness meditation. And because of that meditation, I was able to reprioritize my life completely. And in that reprioritization, now the first priority is spirituality. Second is health. Third priority is relationships, exchange of love. And the fourth is work. And I have come to this conclusion that if the first three are done properly, then the fourth happens very efficiently, automatically. So that is how I have been, because of this meditation and yoga, both, I have been able to take this work-life balance together.
Oh, great. Mr. Bhatia, I would like to ask whether the intensive practice of heartfulness meditation also automatically results in an attitudinal change towards life, your attitude towards life. Does it also undergo a transformation automatically along with this practice, meditation practice?
Yes, Yes. In fact, for me, the whole life changed completely. And attitude is one part of that. You are aware that anyone who comes into IAS is normally very highly competitive. I was also very aggressive, I'm Punjabi. So I was very, very aggressive, could get very angry many times. But when I started doing this meditation, I think within 6 months, the personality started changing. And I have noticed this. I also took some psychometric tests. Mm-hmm. And here it used to be A plus personality. And now it is between A plus and B. A balance has come. And I have also noticed something else. It's not that I don't get angry now. I get angry, but it goes away very fast. It gets dissolved very quickly. Sometimes I even forget. After some time, this whole thing completely disappears. So I would say that if you want to draw a graph of earlier, there were huge peaks of anger, and then you can go down also downwards. And now that flat has come down, it's become a balanced sort of a thing. And I'm also looking at things very, very differently. Even in work life, in fact, in work life, I just mentioned the balance part, but through this meditation, there are other things which have improved. I have seen my efficiency improve because the concentration levels changed. This is a very specific, special meditation where you do not concentrate during the meditation. I have done 9 meditations before I came to this meditation. Everywhere, you are concentrating on one thing, either you're doing a mantra or you're looking at your breath or you're doing something else. In this meditation, you do not concentrate. But improved concentration is a result of this meditation. And I have seen that in my personal life, that the concentration levels change. Another thing which changed, I saw that the creativity levels also started changing. And I'm now not only about myself, whichever organization I headed in organization, where I introduced meditation, all those who were doing meditation, their creativity levels started changing. They became more and more creative. Mm-hmm. I've noticed, I'm only talking about the attitude part here, is that even the intuition improved. I never had, and normally ladies have a lot of excellent intuition. I never had any intuition of that, but now I feel that my heart tells me sometimes even beforehand that this is the right thing, it's not the right thing. Sometimes even when you're opening a file, Telang will agree with me. It opens on the right space completely. I need to read this page very carefully. So this is all those. This is how the work life changed, family life changed, social life changed. Then the revelations came, but I think I'll go into that.
Okay. Thank you so much, Mr. Bhatia. I would like to go to Mr. Telang. At the personal level, you have been practicing for the past 14 years, heartfulness meditation. At the personal level, how has it helped you maintain this work-life balance? How have you benefited?
What I feel is that this balance is a dynamic balance. You know, it's not a static balance. So people find it sometimes difficult because it's always dynamic. Let me take an example of a bicycle or maybe a moving object. So bicycle is balanced only when it is moving. Try to balance when it is static, it will not balance. And the problem, I think, today is that most people are trying to balance a static bicycle and therefore finding it very difficult to balance. So this dynamism in life, that is what keeps life in balance. And that dynamism comes when you are able to bring spirituality into picture. See, if it's only one aspect, let us say there is a bird with only one wing, it will not be able to fly.
Yeah.
So you need two wings to fly.
Yes, very good.
And then there is the status of balance comes into picture. For me, the life has become balanced the moment the aspect of spirituality has come into life. Before that, of course, I was also running. I was also, as sir mentioned, trying to achieve something all the time. So after doing my M.Tech from IIT Kanpur and, you know, one is never satisfied. I mean, one is never content with what is there in life. So you are trying to all the time get something, achieve something. And then after achieving something, you are already looking for achieving something else. So this this quest or this race actually doesn't stop anywhere unless and until you bring life in balance. Now, of course, even now, there is a race, but it's a different kind of a race. Mm-hmm. Now it's more inwards than outwards. The one is trying to get to your own essence, to near to your own essence, maybe at a faster rate. And therefore, the outward life also is in balance. Mm-hmm. To give you an example, another example, let us say you are in midst of a twister or a storm or somewhere. The only place which is stable or static is the center. Mm-hmm. So if you are, your consciousness is at the periphery, mm-hmm. you will always be whirling from one end to other. Mm-hmm. Unless and until your consciousness is centered, then only there is this feeling of balance which will come. Once that balance comes in, then everything is in balance. Whether it is work, whether it is life, whether it is play, I mean anything. Even if you are cooking, it's your life is in balance. When you are reading, it's in balance. Yes.
I would like to ask, you know, you mentioned about achieving this work-life balance. And but it is not something like you reach a destination and then you stop at that, because you are operating in an ecosystem which is full of competition. There are always people wanting to pull you down, wanting to overtake you from the left, and then want to run you down. And to, because, you know, it is a rat race. And like what somebody beautifully said, it, even if you win the rat race, you're still a rat. But people don't realize that. So it is a constant. So is it that even after achieving this work-life balance, you have to constantly struggle and ensure that the external ecosystem in which you are operating, say in your case as an IAS officer, does not disturb this balance?
True. In fact, Sanjay sir will be in a better position because he is in a place where this, what you are saying is more pertinent. Even in our case, wherein we are working here in the state governments, it is true. External situations will always change. External conditions will always try to put life off balance. So, when a part of you, which is the innermost core, if you are able to remain in touch with that, as sir mentioned also, it's not that we don't get angry. It's not that we don't get affected by the external circumstances. Yeah. The point is that how quickly are you able to regain your balance? It's not that you will not be thrown off balance. It's the ability to come back to a situation of balance and respond.
Yeah.
It's a question of the difference between reacting and responding.
Responding, yeah.
And the response has to come.
Yeah.
You can't avoid a response. Mm-hmm. But most of the time we are not responding to a situation, we are reacting to a situation.
Reacting, that's right.
Because we don't have that little element of time where we are able to just remove ourselves from that situation for a moment and then respond. To be able to respond to a situation, you should be able to detach yourself from that situation even for a moment. And then only you will be able to respond. Otherwise, you will flow with the situation. The situation will take over. I think sir has a larger experience. I'd like sir to comment on this.
I would like to know. I'm coming to Mr. Bhatia. But is that you have not only practiced this work-life balance through meditation and all that, but in every organization which you have headed, you have tried to introduce this concept of heartfulness meditation to the employees from the lowest level upwards kind of thing. What has been your experience? What kind of feedback you got? How the employees have benefited by your initiative?
Okay, Balaji, first to answer what Ravinder asked. Yeah, probably in Mumbai, I'm facing more situations than in Gangtok, but all IAS officers face this situation. What I have seen is once the meditation started and you started getting in touch with your divinity, then the external things are not that material. They start getting a little, you start getting a little attached also. External things are happening. They will always happen. In fact, let me give you the latest news. I am in quarantine today. My servant quarter, a positive one person has become positive. So the whole family is in quarantine. But I am happy. There's no issue. Even if I catch corona tomorrow, it's okay. So that is the type of balance which this divinity from the core brings.
Okay.
So other, I have seen people absolutely falling. They not if they even hear of corona nearby, they start becoming so scared. And here it's there. In my house, it is there. My house itself in the servant quarter today, there is a patient of positive corona today. And they are all under quarantine for 14 days. And we have all given tests and the reports are coming tomorrow morning. But this situation is there. I am okay. I have accepted. And because this situation has been accepted, it is not really affecting me that much. In the beginning, when I heard that this patient is like that and staying in the house and his mother is coming and cooking in our house every day from the servant quarter, and which is there in the house itself. A little, in the beginning, a little worry did come. What will happen now? Are we also catching it? But soon I went from the worry part to the solutions part. So what do we do next? What do you do next? So we said, okay, we separate that guy. We give him a separate room. We got all of us got tested. And then how to manage the house? Anybody who's been in contact with that person cannot enter the house. All these things, we start working towards the solutions. So these situations in our life, especially in Mumbai, are coming almost on a daily basis. I have a hospital in Mumbai Port. We have a hospital, Balaji, you would probably know. And the hospital is creating so many issues. Because in the beginning, when this corona thing started, the nurses and the doctors did not realize that this patient could be corona. They took the person to the ICU. And after 3 hours, the person was shifted to the COVID ward. In that 3 hours, 16 people, nurses and doctors, had to go to on a quarantine. Subsequently, that is continuing. So nurses are scared. They want to know what to do. We have provided them PPEs. So what I'm trying to say is the situations are there every day. So rather than, like Ravinder said, rather than worrying about it or reacting for it, you cool down and find a solution. Start moving towards the solutions to this situation. Also, I must say that I have become more accepting now, that there will be a solution daily. There will be an issue daily. You accept the situation. There will be a person also, you may have an issue. You accept the person also. No issue. Everybody is different. And it is our uniqueness which is good for this society. If everybody was like Sanjay Bhatia, this society would be so boring. So everybody...
I don't agree with you on this score.
Everybody is unique. So appreciate that uniqueness, accept that uniqueness, and just be happy about it. So this was the first part of my what Ravinder raised, the work-life balance. In the second part, what you asked me about the organizations, you know, in the beginning when I started doing this meditation, I was in sales tax. I was commissioner of sales tax. Yeah. And the training institutes, I introduced this meditation. Like I said in the beginning, I saw their integrity improved. In fact, their honesty improved. This is one tool. People who are doing this meditation, their masks start disappearing. Otherwise, you know, all of us are wearing various kinds of masks. Before a senior, I wear a different mask. Before a junior, a different mask. In the family, a different mask. A different personality emerging every time. But these masks start disappearing. And person becomes one. And therefore, he becomes, his integrity improves. The person's integrity. Another thing I noticed, which is very important. In fact, the people should know this. This tool is something which brings loyalty to the organization. Very simple. Those people who were doing this meditation, and I saw this in Sales Tax, I saw this in CITCO, and I've seen this in Mumbai Port. I've introduced meditation in all these three places. This being more loyal to the organization.
That's very interesting.
But organization also, a leader would love to, a CEO would love to have people loyal to the organization completely. Yeah. So this tool doing, this meditation has been doing this. Besides what I said in the beginning, their creativity improves, the concentration levels improve. I also saw that they became more loyal to me also, not only to the organization. So the leader, that was also something very surprising.
Apart from loyalty, has the performance of the employees also improved because of this meditation?
I will not be able to say straight away the performance improved, but I'll give you an example. And maybe from that you can determine the... I'm talking about performance now in a very holistic manner. A particular performance is doing two files or three files. I am not aware of that. But probably you will know this example which I'm saying. Mumbai has an airport, and this airport has been now crowded for the last, how many, about 20 years?
Easily.
Okay. In 1990s, the state government had taken a decision to make a new airport in Navi Mumbai.
Yes.
And in 1997, a Bhumi Pujan was done. A board was put, this is the place where your new airport is going to come. But it was now the CITCO and the project affected persons, because CITCO had 1,000 hectares of land, but it did not have 200 additional hectares of land required for the airport. And CITCO and the PAPs were like this. They did not trust each other at all. Not at all. So from 1997 to 2013, no airport, no work on the airport could start. I joined. I did not know that going to be the result. I started meditation among my employees. I also started meditating the PAPs. And then we will also have some joint meditation.
So the PAPs also. Okay.
Doing joint meditation. We had a big hall. So I would invite everyone. Okay, sab log aajo. And let's have a meditation. It did not happen in 3 months or 6 months. It took me about a year, more than a year. 5% of those PAPs surrendered their land. Of course, we gave them a good offer. But they surrendered their lands. And you are aware that that new airport is now going on there. Performance-wise, if you now look at holistically, trust developed. And I attribute this trust to this reasoning. That because of this trust, this huge problem could be resolved. So performance, look at a small performance, this is a huge performance improvement.
I would like to add to that what sir said. As what sir said, basically, it's a question of working in harmony. And that brings result. Government, of course, unlike private sector, is not led by profit parameters.
So the
harmony in organization will definitely improve performance over time. Most of the time, government performance in a department is pulled down because of internal conflict of interest. Their own personal agendas are coming into picture.
So once
we are able to bring in harmony, because I have also tried to do this in some of the organizations, and I have found that people have become more harmonious. And okay. once they become harmonious, the teamwork improves.
Okay.
And that would automatically lead to improved performance. Mm-hmm. So harmony, trust, all these values
okay.
Which get infused due to meditation. Not yeah. If you give a lecture on trust and harmony, I think it won't make any difference because they have been listening to these lectures for umpteen number of times in our academies, in our training institution. Yeah. We have been bombarding them actually with lectures and classes, and no to no effect.
Yeah.
But once it starts to come from inside,
that's very interesting.
Then of course it is a real harmony or a real yeah. trust building which takes place.
Yeah. Mr. Telang, since you have got a strong science background, IIT, Kanpur, and all that, I would like to ask this work-life balance through meditation, through heartfulness, philosophy, and all that. Is it a matter of science or is it an art?
I think it is definitely a science because art is only as far as, it gets personalized, then of course, how you implement it in your life, that becomes an art. But the basis is definitely scientific. Mm-hmm. In a system, for example, any system, any physical system you take, it has entropy. Entropy mm-hmm. is essentially disorder. Mm-hmm. Disorder essentially means dissipation of energy mm-hmm. into something which is not useful for the system. Mm-hmm. So, in physics also, we have this concept that mm-hmm. lower is the entropy of the system, higher is the efficiency. In my mechanical engineering, we used to study thermodynamics. And mm-hmm. The second law of thermodynamics used to say that the efficiency of an engine cannot exceed a particular quantity. It cannot exceed. Why? Because entropy inherent in the system.
Okay.
So I think there is a huge science behind meditation. It reduces entropy. Now, even in your brain, let us say, mm-hmm. it's a network of neurons, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And all these neurons are organizing and reorganizing every moment.
Yeah.
And as we grow in age, as we grow in, as we get become old,
yeah.
The networks become more and more rigid.
Mm-hmm.
And we tend to lose the elasticity or plasticity, whatever it is called, neuroplasticity is, I think, the term which is used. And then we become rigid in our attitudes, rigid in our behavior. We become fixed.
Mm-hmm.
So then it is very difficult to accept change,
mm-hmm.
to accept people with a different background, because now this prejudice or this has become deep rooted in your neurons.
Okay.
So through meditation, we improve the neuroplasticity of our system. So there is a science. There is definitely a science behind all this. It's not just a matter of personal experience. There is a definite science behind all this meditation, and heartfulness meditation goes a step forward.
Okay. In what way? Can you elaborate, please?
See, usually people think that it is the peace of mind. Mind is the instrument.
Mm-hmm.
But the center is the heart.
Mm-hmm.
If you are restless mm-hmm. at your heart, whatever you may do, your mind will not be at peace. For example, I give you an example. If I have done something which is not correct,
mm-hmm.
my heart will definitely give me a signal that, look, this is not correct, don't do it.
Mm-hmm.
But when I weigh that action in my mind, I have to look at the profit and loss of the action.
Mm.
And therefore, more and more I'll tend to do an action which is profitable only in the short term. Though my heart is giving a signal, see, this is not correct.
Mm-hmm.
So mm-hmm. what happens is that my heart will not be at peace. Though I have mm-hmm. come through my logic, through my training, through my whatever, to a decision, mm-hmm. no, this is the action which I have to take. Once my heart is not at peace, whatever I may do with my mind, it will not come to a state of balance. It can never come to a state of balance unless and until my heart is clear, my conscience is clear. And therefore, the heartfulness meditation goes one step ahead of other kinds of meditation. Okay. It goes into
that's
the
really
heart.
Very interesting.
So there, we set things right. Once you are peaceful at your heart, when you are in harmony with your self, which is the heart, then mind becomes peaceful on its own. So that is why, what is the effectiveness of heartfulness meditation, which is my personal experience by doing it.
Okay, very interesting.
Yeah.
Mr. Bhatia, I would like to ask, now that we are living in a situation of deep crisis, so many people are losing job, the businesses are getting shut down and all that, and the people don't know how exactly to handle this crisis. Do you think this is the time wherein kind of heartfulness meditation with the goal of achieving work-life balance and all that, this is the time to kind of spread this concept of meditation even more? And if it has got a kind of government patronage, don't you think it will be of huge help to millions of people in our country?
Yeah, yeah, very, very true what you are saying. In fact, I take it almost like a tool which brings balance. You saw my bio data. I've done an MBA from Southern Cross University.
Yeah, that's Australia.
In the MBA, they teach a subject called change management. Okay. Right? All those tools, none of them work. This is the one which works because it changes a person from inside.
Okay.
Or it is very, very important. One, of course, changing from inside and bringing balance. And in a crisis, this is the most helpful. I'll give you the example of my daughters. Now, in my whole family now, everybody is doing meditation. My wife is doing. My two daughters are doing meditation. They don't do it regularly. They will do it once in a while, but they are aware that this tool is available. Whenever there is a problem, they'll say, Papa, give me a sitting. Once that sitting has happened, their problem has disappeared. I mean, from inside, like what Ravinder just said, the heart becomes clean. So that's
very important.
The problem part, what is stinging you inside, that goes away. The actual problem is they're still outside. But inside you become peaceful. So they use it as a tool. Both of them, both the daughters, I've seen that. And this is so important for today's youngsters. Their IQ levels are way ahead of us, but their EQ levels are much lower. Emotional. So anything, give us little praise and they're the top of the world. And somebody says something, they're ready to order a divorce right away.
Yeah.
But this is so important to do this meditation. Whenever there's a problem, they know, even if they are not doing it regularly, they know that, okay, this problem can be handled. I have this backing of this meditation. Just a sitting and the problem.
That is important.
So in a pandemic or in a crisis like this, when everybody, there is so much stress happening, it's even important to do. In fact, everyone is, and every day probably I'm doing a webinar now on meditation. You'll be surprised. These National Police Academy, where IPS officers are in Hyderabad, he is there, Atul Karwal. He said, I want to start meditation for all these guys. So we are doing a webinar every day.
Okay.
All the IPS probationers are doing meditation. Similarly, it is being done. So it is something, and we have the time also right now. So use. Also telling everyone, use this time, and this probably the nature, of course, is redoing itself outside. Everything is so clean, and so this is the time. Otherwise, what we do, we keep looking for leisure time. We keep looking, when do I sit with my family? I'm there doing my work most of the time. We keep looking for a holiday, and we have been given these holidays in which you are with your. Do your meditation, do your yoga, enhance your consciousness level. So this is the right time absolutely to do this.
Mr. Bhatia, since you are a senior trainer in heartfulness meditation, I want to know whether this takes Raj Yoga further or is it another version of Raj Yoga?
Okay, so this is Raj Yoga. Now, I did 9 meditations, so I am aware of other Raj Yoga meditations like Kriya Yoga. Brahm Kumaris also are doing Raj Yoga. So what happens in this meditation, the difference is of yogic transmission. In fact, in the first time I took a sitting and I was in Bagdad at that time and I was on election duty and the superintendent said, I'll teach you this new meditation. I was doing something else at that time. Mm-hmm. And that he said, from me, yogic transmission is going to flow to you. I said, are you joking? I was in the board at that time. So I was dealing with, I said, isko kuch aur, I need to teach him something else. But when he gave me the sitting and I actually experienced something different because of the yogic transmission. Mm-hmm. So this main difference. Everywhere else, except Vipassana, the meditation which I did, everywhere else it was something like somebody is telling you something and you're believing it. Mm. Here, meditation, you are experiencing it. And the main difference is coming from this yogic transmission concept. Because that yoga is through a particular system of cleaning, is enhancing your, is joining you to your yoga. It is doing the real yoga.
Yeah.
To the divinity. Joining
that, that's right. Yeah.
So this is, that is why it's been now so many years. I continued with this meditation and became a teacher also, a preceptor. Mm. There is also a teacher. My wife is also a teacher now.
Oh, good. Okay. There are
10 lakh people. Earlier, it used to be completely a secret meditation. Now there are, once it has been spread, now there are 10 lakh people who are doing it. There are 10,000 preceptors like me. 10,000 teachers who are teaching this, giving this sittings. And speciality about this is that you can do it in this pandemic also because you can do it remotely.
So yeah.
Being given remotely.
Yeah.
This arts app which has been prepared. One needs to just download it, do the 3 master classes, and then you want something from a preceptor, anybody, any preceptor in the world at that time or online, he'll give you a sitting. A remote sitting. This is the benefit of
it. Okay. That's right. Mr. Telang, I would like to you to take what Mr. Bhatia said further. Is it that you are in this world with all the competition, with all the thing which kind of happens, all the negative thing which happens, at the same time you are not in this world because of this meditation?
Let me first start where Sanjay sir left. Issue of crisis. To give you an example, the tree which has got deep roots will stand the storm. Once you are having, what should I say, inner strength or your inner connection is so strong that external storms will blow here and there, but still you will be able to maintain your balance or poise. So that is how even in a crisis, this becomes more prominent. Now, I can't imagine what sir is describing now, that there is a corona positive case nearby, very nearby, in fact, right in his house. And he is doing a webinar telling about meditation to people. And it's not something which is theory. I mean, it is there, which is a practical demonstration, which is right there in front of us.
Yes.
So it's not a preaching. So the beauty of this meditation is that it is not something which is to be preached. You know, it's for somebody else to do it. Most of the time, what happens is that, you know, we expect somebody else to do something. Here, you are supposed to do it yourself and then demonstrate and then others will catch that as an experience, or other will learn from your presence. So that is what happens In the times of crisis, in fact, this is more pronouncedly, what should I say, it becomes more pronounced. Your stability, mm-hmm. your poise, your inner strength, because all these resources are the resources of the heart. Mm-hmm. And therefore, if you talk of courage, where does the courage comes from? You know, you say he's a large-hearted fellow, or he's mm-hmm. a fellow with a big heart. It's basically mm-hmm. coming from the heart. All these mm-hmm. resources which are required in these times of crisis are within your heart, within yourself. Mm-hmm. You just have to kind of log in to use mm-hmm. the computer terminology to access those resources, or maybe download those resources which are already available. The only thing is that we lack the connection. The network speed is not there. And therefore this transmission comes into picture. It's kind of a link between your own inner strength, your own inner resources, and your present level of consciousness.
Your would you say level, you become yeah. more compassionate? Your heart is filled with compassion if you do this kind of meditation? You become...
Definitely. See, again, let me share my experience. Before doing this meditation, Sir was also doing, I think he has done 10 types of meditation. I was doing something else. And I used to read Bhagavad Gita also. I used to read so many other literatures also. Mm-hmm. But I would say my heart was not open. Mm-hmm. See, this openness of heart comes, it's something, you know, which you can't really describe. You can experience it. Mm-hmm. This issue of empathy and sympathy. Mm-hmm. Earlier, maybe I was sympathetic to somebody. Mm-hmm. I could, you know, probably I was even having pity on somebody's condition. Mm-hmm. But I was not able to empathize mm-hmm. with that person. Mm-hmm. Empathy is something which comes with openness of the heart. Mm-hmm. And this meditation has helped me greatly to become more empathic. I mean, to develop more empathy. So that is what happens. And it has not happened by any conscious effort. It is not that I made an effort to become more, you know, empathetic to some people. It has come on its own.
Okay.
And when you look back, then only you are able to say that, mm-hmm. okay, this was my reactions on those times. Now this is my reaction in these times. Mm-hmm. So that is how the difference comes into picture.
Okay. That's very good. Mr. Bhatia, I would like to come back to you. You have been within the system, the IS system, the political system which is there in your country. Yet you have been able to introduce a lot of changes. You have been able to bring about tremendous transparency and corruption-free atmosphere in whichever organization you kind of know headed. So, but do you think it is difficult? Was it difficult for you to bring about this kind of a transformation within the system, even as you are very much part of the system, or is it something else?
Okay, so maybe I am very fortunate that I am in Maharashtra Garden.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow, everybody supported.
Okay.
Whenever I was taking any steps against corruption, or introducing meditation, I would get a general support even from the politicians. So
okay.
I think I have been very fortunate. I don't know whether in other states this was mm-hmm. possible, but somehow mm-hmm. I am fortunate because I stopped becoming very highly competitive and all, and people could see that the heart is clean. So they started mm-hmm. agreeing with me. But mm-hmm. I have seen this culture itself that mm-hmm. in the heart people want to be honest. People mm-hmm. want to have the integrity. People are worshippers. They are of that culture where they appreciate these things. So it was not difficult for me to introduce these things here. So this has been my experience. I know some of my batchmates have not been that successful in other states, but has been, I would say it's a lovely state. And the politicians have also helped, everybody has helped. And we have been able to, I actually don't bother about what is happening somewhere else. I am concerned with what I am doing. So, pehle seedha rakho, phir dusron ke saath meditation. Do the meditation.
That is that we are now living in India where it is becoming extremely consumerist, like in the West, and the pursuit of Goddess Lakshmi appears to be the full-time avocation of many Indians. I won't say most Indians, but many Indians. So where they are willing to cut corners, break and bend rules any which way, to make more and more money, kind of thing. In such a scenario, how this the pursuit of work-life balance comes into play?
I'll take it, sir.
Yeah, I'll take it.
Okay. See, the point again is that whether it's a question of money, whether it's a question of power, whether it is a question of luxuries of life, I think it's a question of how do you find yourself balanced. Whether, see, the realization that where does happiness lies, where does contentment lie? Once people are able to realize this, I think they will be able to understand that there is a purpose of making money also. Why do you make money? Why do you want power? What is the purpose? What is the goal? Now, once we are able to reset or able to understand that money is there for a purpose, then one will realize that they already have enough. See, because the purpose is fulfilled. See, money making in itself is not a purpose. It is for some purpose. It's a means to achieve something. The common mistake which people are making is that they think that making money itself is a purpose.
It's an end in itself.
It means to do something. Power is there to do something. Power in itself is not a purpose. So we get confused between means and ends, and that is what probably is happening. And people are getting confused between, see, what is the goal? What is the purpose? If I want to become happy, how much money I need to become happy and to what extent? So my purpose is not clear, and therefore I am running in circles.
Sorry to interrupt. You have been in Sikkim for close to 25 years now. Would you say that the people of Sikkim, they are living a life of harmony much more than, say, the people of Mumbai?
As sir will be able to tell about Mumbai, in Sikkim, what I have experienced is that people are close to nature. And in these high hills and steep hills, life is not very certain at times. You know, nature takes over. There are in villages, people are not sure whether tomorrow the connecting link between their village and Gangtok will remain open or not, or overnight rain will cause a landslide and the link will be broken. So they are more living in present, in the sense that they are more living for today. They're not bothered about tomorrow, because tomorrow is quite uncertain for them. They are more close to nature. They are more respectful of nature. And that brings in an attitude of helping each other. Because there is one crisis or the other always there. Either there is a landslide, or there is a hailstorm, or there is a some kind of trouble will always be there with nature. So I think people have developed this, a kind of connection with each other. and they have realized that they can survive only as a group. So that individualistic attitude is little less. And harmony with nature is little more. And that makes you, I mean, people are a little different. They're more disciplined also. If you see, compare Sikkim with other parts of the country, people are more disciplined. They like to be disciplined. They're law abiding. So there are very, I mean, the crime rate in Sikkim is probably least in the country. You know, we sometimes, if some murder takes place, it's a huge, news. I mean, once in a year or twice in a year, you know, there is a murder or somewhere. So that way, people are more peaceful and in harmony with nature. So by nature, that thing is there in people of Sikkim. And of course, I think Buddhism also had its impact, because the culture is essentially Buddhist culture. So so that, I think all these factors have made people to be more harmonious.
That's very interesting. Mr. Bhatia, coming back to you, I think we are coming to a close, so it's nearing 11:30. I would like to ask one final question, which is that Daji and his followers like you and Mr. Telang and thousands of you, teachers and all that, have been doing remarkable work to ensure work-life balance through heartfulness meditation. Huge campus is also coming up near Hyderabad, Khanna campus, I believe. What kind of future scenario you see for heartfulness meditation in the years to come? It's already taken the contours of a global movement. Do you think, especially in the context of this corona crisis, it has got a very bright future in bringing solace to the lives of millions of people across the globe? What kind of scenario do you visualize?
Okay, first of all, we are not following Daji. We love him. There's a great difference between these two. He hates us, but we are in love with this guy. We hug him. That is meditation we do. So it's a very, very different meditation. I told you I did 9 meditation. This is something very different. There's a lot of love here. And what Daji has done is that since he came, he has spread it quite a bit. And now people are able to do remotely. Earlier, probably there were 1 lakh or some Abhyasis and about 4,000 or 5,000 preceptors. Like I told you, now there are 10,000 preceptors, 10 lakh Abhyasis, and it's spreading. Because one, of course, that Hyderabad ashram is out of the world completely. Whenever I go there, I tell Daji, you've created Swarg here. And out there, it was all boulders and all, completely rocky area. And if you go there now, it's completely green, completely organic. And when I go there, I used to, till this pandemic came, I was there once in 2 months, spend at least 2-3 days in the ashram. It's so beautiful. The air is so pure. The meditation atmosphere is there. So this, of course, is a center, and such centers are there all over the world. So this movement is spreading. This movement is spreading. And I, mainly because you are actually experiencing everything else what we are doing, like I mentioned in the beginning, you're believing. Your mind is saying, yes, it is correct. Very rational. Very, very rational. The guy is in a lecture. But
the connect is there.
That feeling, here you shift from the mind to the feeling. So when you get a good from the, your heart is telling you, you have reached the right place. So when people start to meditation, this feeling starts and your consciousness level also starts. I see a hugely bright future for this. And it's not that way that we are trying to push it or like that. We have role models. If you have a preceptor is giving a sitting, you experience something, then you like it, you get a good feeling, then you also start doing it. And then when you do it well, your family starts doing it, your friends start doing it. So this is how it is spreading. And I see that it is spreading very, very well. So a very, very good future. And I think necessary for this world. through the yogic transmission, work-life balance. Because here, like Ravinder said, two birds, one bird with two wings. So we have both wings very closely with each other. So your work also improves, so your social life improves, your family life improves, and you also are in touch with divinity. So what else do you want? So
this it's a win-win situation every which way.
Yeah.
Yeah. So on this extremely positive note, I would like to wind up this very, very interesting session with both you, Mr. Sanjay Bhatia, and Mr. Ravinder Telang. It has been a very enriching experience for myself, and I hope it is similarly so for thousands of people who are going to watch this and take part in the discussion whenever it is telecast. Thank you so much.
Thank you, and we enjoyed it very much.
Thank you so much. Take care.